Right, yo, what it do, it's your boy Yellow the Poet, and today I'm here with Miss Arlene Miller. She is a work-life balance coach, definitely has publishing The Jewel Within, and we're going to learn a lot more about what Miss Arlene has been doing with her time. So we're looking forward to learning a lot of new things from Miss Arlene, and first of all, welcome Miss Arlene Miller to YTP Entertainment. It's definitely a pleasure to have you. Please let us know what you got going on.
Well, thank you so much for having me here. I'm really excited. You feel really different. I thought, well, that would be really cool to have a conversation with you. So,
Thank you.
a little bit about me. Yeah, I spent say that with all my heart. A little bit about me is I'm a work-life balance coach for
Motion
women
detected at front door.
and a transformational,
You're fine.
yeah, a transformational healer, and mentor for men and women. And I started off as an attorney and decided I wanted to be that when I was very young and did all that stuff. And then about, I don't know, 5 years before I left the practice, I became a coach. I went through a coaching program. I went through a transformational holistic counseling program. I became a certified mentor. I didn't know then, but I eventually came to know I was ready for another a path in my life. And that's what I've done, and just sort of going with the flow of the journey.
Oh, wow, that is pretty cool. Starting off as an attorney. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. So what made you want to practice law?
Well, I just felt like I could help people, and my parents were really surprised because there were no attorneys in my family. And I also felt like as a woman that I could definitely take care of myself in the world if I was an attorney. And that what felt really important to me, just to always have that ability to not be dependent on anybody else. Maybe I was a little bit cynical growing up,
Yes.
but yeah, so those were the two motivations, and I'm really glad I learned it. There's a tremendous, I learned a lot from helping other people and being on sort of both sides of working with as an attorney, for representing all kinds of people and just meeting all kinds of people that were attorneys. We were a member of a lot of attorney groups, and I was it was a really cool experience. Got to travel a lot, and I don't regret any of that. I learned some great skills. I can be a pretty much of that kind of woman spiritual warrior if I need to be. So don't mess with me kind of person. But I can also be very, very different as well. More of that feminine, allowing, surrendering kind of person. So I'm grateful for it all.
Awesome. That is awesome. And we need a lot more women's empowerment. So I'm looking forward to Miss Camilla being president. Definitely a change after having so many male figures in office. This is We need a change. We need something different now. And I'm all for women's empowerment because I feel like women don't get enough recognition for all the things that they are capable of, for one, and then for all the things that they do. Now, irregardless of where they are in life, irregardless to if you're successful, not successful, if you're in the medical field, if you're an attorney, if you're coaching, is irregardless to where women are, I feel like they don't get enough recognition for all the things that they do. So I'm all for the women's empowerment.
And I'm not like a real, I'm more like a, here I am. But I guess it's really important as well too, because there's been so much guilt, and shame and of not of doing things to take care of ourselves. And that's what I feel is really important to change as well. That engaging in self-love and self-care is something that everyone needs to do. And I sort of saw the opposite from my mother. She like did everything for the kids. But we didn't even buy clothes for herself. I can
Yes.
remember as a teenager going, "Mom, I have plenty of clothes. Go buy yourself an outfit." Because that's how women were changed, were
Yes.
trained. And so I really think that that's a big part of it too, just dropping all that guilt stuff and being willing to love and take care of ourselves the way we've done with other people and, the people we love.
Right. Yes, I understand that definitely because I was raised by my grandmother, and my grandmother a lot of times sacrificed in order for us to have things. And when I got old enough to understand and see, just really pay more attention to how she was sacrificing for us, I'm like, Grandma, you really need to do something for yourself. Like, I'm going to be okay. Regardless, I'm going to be okay. So how about you do something for yourself? And after a while, she did, after hearing her siblings and her children saying things, like, she did actually start doing some things for herself. But it took a while.
Yeah, it did.
I've adopted that selfless mentality that she had, and I'm grateful to have it. But at the same time, I've learned to also create balance between being selfless and sometimes having to take something and do something for myself. So.
Yeah, because if we don't fill our own cup up with love, the well is going to run dry and we're going to crash and burn. So it's really, we're actually being more of service. If we take time to fill our own cup up with love, we can be of more service because we're going to be more compassionate and kind and caring because those are the things that we're embodying.
Yes, indeed. I totally agree with you on that. I totally agree. Where did my camera go? Disappeared on me.
There's a cool picture of me with some really crazy hat on that was really interesting for a moment.
So tell us a little bit more about polishing the jewel within. I like that. Just it's kind of broad and for a person who doesn't really understand what's going on, but I like the way that sound, polishing the jewel within.
Yeah, it's like I sort of view, like all that we have many facets to ourselves in our lives, and I've had people say, what's more important or how do you distinguish like being a work-life balance coach for women and like being a transformational mentor for men and women or other things that I do. And I just sort of view them as all aspects of the same jewel of who I am. And I think that's what's true for all of us. We're all multidimensional. We do a lot of things. We have a lot of gifts. And there's some things that need more polishing on that jewel than others. I know that I do. I'm raising my hand for that. I can be a little bit impatient, or we all have these that are not our strengths. And so we're in the process of polishing the bits that need to be polished and acknowledging the bits that are strengths. But it's all a part of who we are. And I feel like it's like viewing myself as all these aspects of myself, like these are my brothers and sisters, or however you want to view it. So it's not like one is better than the other. They're just all different aspects of who we are, and some are more polished than others. And that way we bring more of our whole self to everything that we do.
Yes, indeed. I totally agree with you on that, no doubt. Because it takes a lot to actually recognize, for one, that you need the type of help that you need for yourself. You always recognize that helping others is something that you wanted to do, but recognizing that you need that help yourself is when it gets a little complicated because you're more focused and more driven on helping others a lot of times than you are on helping yourself. So it's a challenge. It's a challenge. And I'm willing to admit that, yeah, a lot of times I haven't been always focused on self. I've been more driven helping other people rather than looking out for myself. And it's fine. I mean, after you learn to create that balance, create a double focus, not just a focus for others, but also that focus for yourself, then the appreciation that you have for having your abilities, excuse me, and using your abilities to do things for others, it grows, and it's a growing process. It's a growth process, and it helps you to understand more about why you do the things that you do to become that selfless person.
And I think we can be selfless and give back to ourselves. And I always feel like as we give, so we receive. As we receive, so we give. It becomes like this beautiful cycle. Sometimes we're just at the checkout counter at the grocery store or something, and we just have this lovely like 1 minute conversation or something with whoever is checking us out. And it's just like it's really cool. Like there's this heart connection, and it's just this special moment, and there's a giving and a receiving. And when we have that cycle going, even if you're selfless and you're doing that, you're still receiving stuff back. Not always, but we can't control what other people do, but it's a beautiful process. When we really take a step back and go, wow, that was a really cool moment, or Yes, I am selfless, but I'm getting so much back from that selflessness as well.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. I love it. I love the whole process. I was also looking at your profile, and one of the things that intrigued me was when you talking about transforming our inner critic into an inner coach. Please enlighten us. Give us more about that.
Well, I think lots of times we're inadvertently trained when we're growing up, to focus on the inner critic, maybe by our friends, maybe by our family, maybe by our teachers, and especially with the people that we love. I've really come to the realization, at least personally, that like my parents did the best that they could. They learned this behavior maybe unconsciously from their parents, and it just sort of gets passed down. And maybe sometimes it's just they want us to be tough in the world. So if someone says something that's not kind to us or even nasty, we'll be strong enough to handle it. But I just really think that it can sort of erode our self-esteem. So we learn these ways to talk to ourselves. It's kind of like that blah, blah, blah in the ear. Like, we make a mistake, we put our foot in our mouth, we do something, we're looking, go look back and go, oh my God, that was not a pretty look. But it's not helpful to go, you stupid idiot, why did you do that? And beat ourselves up and berate ourselves. What I find is a much healthier way to handle things is go, okay, I made a mistake here. This is not who I am. And mistakes are opportunities to learn and grow. So if I take a step back and I feel into, if I had a do-over with this moment or a similar moment, how would I behave? How would I act? How would I be? What would I say that would feel different, look different, and then there would be a different outcome. So we're using that opportunity to change and grow and evolve instead of berating ourselves and cutting ourselves down. And that's like, a really simple first step to take because, we're probably pretty aware when we're calling ourselves an idiot,
Yeah, that's so true. Although sometimes, like when I'm driving, if I make a mistake and not use my turn signal, I'll be like, oh, that was really stupid. I'll say something to myself. I won't say it out loud, but I'll say it to myself and I'm like, okay, I gotta make sure I don't do that again. And but sometimes that self-discipline actually helps because it's just a opportunity to keep yourself on track, especially when you know that you do better most of the time and you're just trying not to consistently make the same mistakes. And then when you're doing that to yourself, you take that as a tool for growth and you are actually doing it to other people, but only difference is without the whole that was stupid, that's not right. Because just like you said, we can actually find other ways to critique people or to give someone advice without being disrespectful. It could be more enlightening than anything. And that's what we want as a coach. We always want to be more enlightening rather than taking a person down a road that's going to make them feel like, oh my goodness, why did I ever even come here?
And you made a really important point because I do that with myself too. I'll like talk to myself like, Arlene, you didn't turn on your turn signal. That is not okay. We're not doing that again. It's like I'm a strong parent to the kid within me. And the way you shared that with yourself, you weren't being judgmental. You're just going, it was different than when I was re-rating myself before. There was no judgment there. It's just like, hey, that's not cool. That could cause an accident. We're not doing that one. So that's a totally kind of different kind of thing. And I think we really need to distinguish the two with the intention and the feeling that comes from how we're talking to ourselves, no matter what the words are.
That is so true. That is so true. I like that. And just like you said, no, we have to distinguish the difference between the two. And that's one of the things that, as a coach, because I do the relationship coaching, so that's one of the things that I talk to people about is knowing the difference between a debate and an argument. Let's know the difference between a male and a female because a male and a female on many levels communicate differently, they think differently, they react to things differently, and they just overall do things differently. But there's always a point where you can say, hey, let's sit down and talk about it and let's see if we can actually come to an understanding. And then that's when points of views, especially when you can give multiple points of views, at some point, one of those points of views will actually register with the other person. And when that happens, now we've had an opportunity to grow with one another and we can move on to something differently because now we've grown from this one incident to a whole new way of thinking or a whole new way of doing things. And that's what a lot of people, when I talk to them about, they don't see that difference in multiple points of views. It's just like when you're talking to a 2 or 3 year old. If you're talking to that 2 or 3 year old and you're like, hey, don't do this, and then they go right back a few seconds later and do it again, you kind of like have to do the same thing with other people. If they didn't understand the way you said it the first time, change the way that you said it. Don't repeat it. Change the way that you said it and see if they can probably catch on to it then, because there may be certain key words that people don't understand that we're using. Sometimes as a college graduate, we use words that other people who haven't educated themselves on don't really understand what we're saying. And it's not about whether you're a college graduate, master's degree, PhD, or anything like that. It's just about having an open dialogue and being able to communicate people on the level in which they understand.
Yeah. And I learned something from Brené Brown. I don't know if you've heard of her, but she really gave something when it came to relationships that has really stuck with me. And it's a way, it's like you come to the person that you love and go, the story that I'm telling myself is, and it might be something simple as, you don't love me because, or you're angry with me because, and you allow the other person to respond to you as part of that communication thing. And that just feels so beautiful because when we come to these conversations like you're talking about, it's important that we're not in reaction or charged, or all that energy is going to come in and we're not going to be able to come to some sort of, meeting of the minds or whatever you want to call it. So, yeah, I just love that because it can be in business, it can be in relationships, it can be anywhere, because oftentimes the story that we've concocted in our head is so far from the truth. If we think that to the other person without judgment and they get to hear it, they go like, whoa, where did you come up with that one? And it can actually start a really cool dialogue, which is supporting your inner coach and their inner coach at the same time.
Yes, that is so true. That is so true. I can understand that because I have a little bit of a different approach. My approach is instead of getting angry when the other person is getting angry, question them and ask them what were their triggers, what made them so angry, and explain to them too that you're not trying to be condescending or not trying to, say something to trigger you again. I just want you to understand that I'm trying to grow with you. And if you allow me to grow with you, then we can continue to grow together this way. But I have to understand things about you in order to not trigger you again.
That's beautiful because you're coming from such a judgment-free space and you're really being kind and compassionate. You're not buying into their reaction. And it gives the other person the opportunity to go, oh, he really wants to hear what I have to say. He's really interested. And of course, that's going to engender a free and open conversation. But a lot of people don't have that skill that you have. So that's a great thing that I to impart to your audience that you probably told them before, but it's a wonderful way to approach. Having healthy, strong, loving relationships. I love that.
Yes, indeed. And even now, like with me and my wife, we talk quite a bit, and I love having the conversations with my wife. And even if we don't see the same things, I question, and now sometimes she question, like, what makes you not like this, or what makes this so different to you? And we'll talk about it, and it's actually fun because it's something that gives us an opportunity to build a stronger relationship on. And the
Yeah.
great part is you never stop growing the more you're doing it.
Yeah. That's really, really cool. That's a lovely way to have a relationship because then the both of you are so open-minded. You're not really judging the other person. You might still not agree with them, but you're still going to love them anyway. You're going to have a deeper understanding of their why.
Yes, indeed. And that's important. That's important to understand their why, understand their points of views, understand their how, understanding, like, excuse me. There's one other thing that a lot of people in relationships didn't think about when I had coached this couple, this married couple. They didn't take into consideration the one another's backgrounds. So understanding another person's background too will actually help you to be able to understand why certain reactions are done, certain characteristics were built, certain traits were built. And if you can actually work around those things, if those are not some things that you can work around, then these things need to be explained in the beginning and not try to fall in love with a person. And then you're just like, oh my goodness, why did I do this? So I tell my children, and I told them, I say, before you start claiming a relationship, because there's a difference in claiming a relationship and actually saying we're going to get into a relationship. Because one of the things is when you check out a person and you want to see what that person is like, you want to see what they're like with you. You want to see what they're like with their parents. You want to see what they're like with their family members and with their friends. So you get to see all of these different ways that this person acts before you claim this to be a relationship. Let's just say we're working on building ourselves into a relationship rather than, excuse me, rather than claiming a relationship. I told my children to try those things first before you start getting into a relationship. And they was like, man, that's a good idea. I've never thought about it like that. And I say, but there's so many of us who don't sit down and talk and try to, lay our cards out and put the cards on the table and say, look, before we try to get into anything, let's get to know each other first.
Yeah. And what I love about that is I work with fairy tales with mentoring. And lots of times we live in our imagination because we don't particularly want to like our life that much. We wish it was different. And part of the fairy tale is having the perfect romance and the perfect love relationship. And we imagine it, and maybe there's somebody that we know that we're putting into that slot. And it's really not helpful. And it's kind of dangerous. And so what we need to do is be fully present here now, loving and enjoying our life as it is, and building from there, and noticing like when we're going into our imagination and we're not really fully present, and we're making things what they're not because we have this deep yearning for something, but it's just really not a healthy way to do it. And that's
Right.
really so cool that you're saying that to your kids, because it's not something that we teach in society. And it's really cool that you're modeling for your coaching clients the relationship stuff, and you're just not telling them what to do, which is a whole different deal. I think that's really important for us, all of us as coaches and mentors, to really work on embodying, what we're sharing, knowing that oftentimes the kind of clients that we attract to us, we're going to be a few steps ahead of them, but we've been there and done that as well, So it's a constant learning experience. So that's a really cool sharing. Thanks for sharing that.
You're welcome. You're welcome. It's just so many things that I've learned because I mean, even I try to take everything that I've learned, like the psychology. I've got 4 years of psychology under my belt. I've got a lot of relationships that I've dealt with, even literally from the age of 12 all the way up to now. There's a lot of different types of relationships I've dealt with. And I've taken everything that I've learned, and I want to be able to say it in a way that's unbiased to anybody, irregardless of what race, creed, color, nationality that these people are. I want to be able to say these things to anybody and make sure that it's actually something that's going to benefit them rather than to cause a hindrance. Because a lot of times when you cause a hindrance, you don't know how deep of a rabbit hole this person is already in before they come to you. Because majority of the time when we meet someone, we're meeting their representatives, we're not actually meeting them. And that was one of the reasons why I came up with that strategy of let's build our relationship first. Excuse me, and then claim it, not claim a relationship and then try and build it. Because 9 out of 10 times, a lot of times when it goes that way, a lot of things go wrong, and there's a lot of regret. There's a lot of maybe I shouldn't have. Then you're questioning yourself and second guessing yourself. So why go through all of that when you can change the narrative and let's build the relationship before we claim it? Once we see that this is something that we want and we both want this same relationship, then let's claim ourselves to be into a relationship, but at the same time, continue to build on it and expound upon the things that you've learned while building that.
Yeah, and I guess what I've learned in relationships is that, especially with not a partner, but other people that are very close to my life, if they were saying something that I didn't want to talk about or whatever, or it just felt a little bit off to me, I would get really, really defensive. And I think that a lot of people do that. And I guess what I've learned is that the more grounded and fully present I am in my heart, no matter what's going on, and know that, these are my boundaries of what I'm willing to talk about or not, or what I'm willing to share or not from a space of fear, but from a space of love, while still appreciating and acknowledging where the person is coming from. Maybe they do have the best intentions from their own heart. It's a lot easier just to drop any kind of defensiveness and be our best self while still having those clear, strong, and appropriate boundaries of what it feels okay to share or not share, or how to be or not be, because sometimes people just sort of poke and want to know stuff that's none of their business, or really need, it just feels like, this, I need to keep this to myself. And I really feel that's also important when we have goals or aspirations. I know I'm going off on a little tangent here, but like our goals or aspirations, like this little tiny seed, the seedling that's coming out of the ground, and we need to love and protect it and not share with a bunch of people who could, sabotage it energetically or project bad things at it. And so sometimes it's just, it's another part of the communication thing you're talking about. We really need to, those goals and things and projects and what we'd like to create on the ground and be a different kind of person, better, clearer, stronger, brighter. We need to love and protect that until like it's a kind of a big, strong tree. I'm not sure why I just shared that, but I just felt that that was part of the conversation
That
when I was supposed to say.
is actually great because it reminds me of the thing that I explained to the males and the females in a relationship about 50-50. So a lot of times males are intimidated by a female that makes more money than them. And sometimes vice versa. It just depends on the mentality of the people. So what I explained to them is this. Let's just say that here's the male and here's the female. And when we're talking, we're like this. We're on the same level. But because of stereotypical information that we've received as we've grown up, you look at the male like this and you look at the female like this. And that's not what it should be. Because let's say, for example, that someone comes to your home, they're selling that item. You both know you need this item, but they ask you a question about how things are at home in terms of the cleanliness. Do you have this? Do you have that? And let's say he's always at work. How can he be the dominant one in that conversation when he doesn't really know everything about at home? He only knows what she tells him. So now 50-50 becomes back here again where it should have been in the first place, and vice versa. So the male should be more apt to support her and stand with her, stand behind her, stand by her side, whatever the case may be in that particular scenario. And allow her to shine in that particular scenario, just long as you show her that you're supporting her in whatever her decision is for this particular scenario, and it should be vice versa.
Yeah.
So that's
And
what
it's,
that what you just
yeah.
said reminded me of.
Yeah. And it also feeds into that one of the things of being humble and having humility is just acknowledging there's lots of things we don't know. I mean, if you want me to show you how to do a yoga posture, I'm right there for you. You want me to fix something in my engine in my car? There's no way. It's just not my area of expertise. So we all have areas of expertise, and we need to acknowledge the other person for the areas of expertise they have and allow them to shine and grow there. And maybe we'll share some of our expertise with them if they're interested, and vice versa. But that is really just a part of being in a healthy relationship, when we're honoring and celebrating the other person. And that's really a part of that inner critic, inner coach thing, because when we have our inner coach, we're acknowledging ourselves for each little success we have during the day. We're not waiting to achieve some big goal or project. And we're also doing it for the people that we love and are in our lives. We're modeling that for them. And when we're both doing that for each other, acknowledging and celebrating all the little successes, not waiting for the big things, and even giving words of support, it does change relationships, and it does actually relate to the topic you brought, that you were interested in today about the inner critic and inner coach. And lots of times we're better at first doing it for somebody else, but when they start doing it for us and we can start doing it for each other, both of us are lifted up, and it's a whole new relationship.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. It's constant growth. And one of the things I told my children is, they say, I want a relationship like yours. I say, well, the first thing that you got to be willing to do is to constantly grow. Because as long as my wife and I have been together, we still grow. Irregardless, we're still growing in this relationship. And it's a beautiful thing when you can reach a peak in your relationship. And then you talk about it, you work out all the ins and outs for that particular peak in the relationship, and now you've elevated to something else, and then life throws another curve at you, and you continue to learn and build from each curve that you've gotten. Then
Yeah.
my children are like, wow, we really didn't think of it like that. I say it's something that you may not think about right now, but as you're going through relationships, there's always something to learn. So always look for something to learn. Don't look for something negative. Just look for something to learn.
Right. Yeah, you're saying exactly what I said in a different way. And what I love about what you're saying is that it's just an acknowledgement that life on earth in this body can be difficult, can be challenging. It can stretch the heck out of us. But if you have that attitude of like, okay, we can do this together, we're both committed to evolving and growing, it's a there's a way that you're synergistically working together to handle whatever life presents from a place of that inner coach. It's not perfect. Of course, there's going to be places where we look back and review and go, whoa, well, I did the best I could at the moment, but I really want to do better next time. So
True
it's a process, but it's really interesting because everything that you're sharing with me, it really can relate back to that inner critic and inner coach, what we give to ourselves and how we relate to other people as well. So this is
Yes,
cool.
yes, indeed. I'm loving it. I'm loving it. This is awesome. So, when you rated yourself as a V-rated attorney, why is that?
Oh, I didn't rate myself as that. That's an AV
Okay.
rated attorney is just when you it's like the highest rating you can get as an attorney. So I
Okay.
just really worked hard and clicked off all the little check marks you had to do. And so that was the attorney that I got rating and did the
Awesome.
best I could and it paid off. So there you go.
That's a beautiful thing. That's a
Yeah,
beautiful
I mean, it's nice to have accomplishments. It doesn't just because someone has an AV rating doesn't mean that you're a compassionate and empathetic and all those
thing.
kind of things person. You have to develop those things too. But yeah, it's nice to be acknowledged for what you bring to, what I brought to the practice of law.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, you definitely seem compassionate. I don't know if anybody else sees that, but you definitely seem compassionate. And so I was looking at all these different things that you've done as coaching, professional certified coaching, International Coaching Federation, a coach facilitator. And you also have the National Coaching Company and the CEO of Jewel. Oh wow. So you definitely knee deep into coaching, no doubt about that.
Yeah, and it's interesting, when I first I went through the certification when I was still a partner in a small firm, and I think just coaching is a great skill for anybody. I mean, I learned how to negotiate better, how to communicate better, how to really listen to people. Because before that, when I listened to people, I was always thinking about what I was going to say, mostly as a comeback, a little bit embarrassing, when they were talking. And you really learn how just to be fully present with people, like you've learned. Through a different mode, but we're all came to the same place, and how cool that is, and how it just changes relationships, and how it's healing, and brings together people as a team as well. So, yeah, that kind of training and the training that I got as a transformational holistic counselor just really helped me to be more empathic and compassionate with people and really more interested, in what was going on for them so that I could, serve better and to, work with the people that were working for us. And so, yeah, I didn't think I was gonna, I incorporated into my law practice to begin with, and I'm like, I think this is what I really want to do. So yeah, I love it. I love having that I had a circuitous journey, and I think a lot of us do. We don't really know why we want to do something, and then years later and go, oh my gosh, I'm so glad I listened.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. You were making me think about how a lot of times you really just said it. You say, I think this is something I really want to do. And you made me think about how a lot of times we get started doing something we've already done before, and then how it correlates to what we really want to do, but we don't really see how much we're getting out of it until we're actually going through it. And that is amazing that you were able to coach in so many different ways for so many different avenues. And that is awesome. So in your coaching experiences, I see that you've learned a lot, but so how much of yourself have you taught differently than the things that you would have done before?
I just feel like I keep on evolving and changing and growing because I really feel that we attract people like I was sharing for mentoring and for coaching who are like us, who have an affinity to us, and we're a few steps ahead of them. We've been through more things, so it's constantly an evolving, learning and growing process, and we just have to be open to it and to be really grateful for it, not to go, oh my gosh, how could I coach this person? I have some of that stuff inside. Because as coaches and mentors, when we're in that role, what I find is that I'm like putting everything, any issue I have about anything, I'm putting it on the table over here. I will deal with that later, but right here, I'm going to be in my heart and fully present for whoever I'm working with. And so it just feels like the people that we attract to work with us are helping us to evolve and grow as we're helping them to evolve and grow. And I'm just really grateful that that's the way it works.
That is awesome. That is awesome. So, Ed, has there ever been a time where you started coaching someone and they were looking to take the co the your coaching or your techniques in a different direction and you had to bring back? How did you handle that?
Well, I always in with mentoring, it's like I have wisdom in my personal development area, so I'm sharing my wisdom with somebody else so they can stand on my shoulders. With coaching, I always feel that my clients have the answers inside of them, and if I am in sync with them and asking powerful questions and sharing my intuitions and insights with them, and they can take or leave them, that they will get to where they need to go. Because sometimes, like us, I've had plenty of journeys that went around in a circle for a while or a way out over here, and I had to pull myself back. Sometimes that's what they need. And if we hold like a really judgment-free, unconditionally loving space for them, maybe where they get to, I don't think it's the right place, but it's perfect for them. And they're going to have an experience and evolve and grow. And maybe they'll eventually come back to where I thought they should. Maybe not. Maybe what I think it's just better for me, but not for them. So even if something looks like, why are you doing that? I feel that it's still their ultimate decision. I've never had a situation where they're really doing something horrendous for themselves, but it would be something different than what I would choose. But I always trust in like the benevolence of the universe and that it's got to be something that's going to help them. It might be a difficult journey, more difficult that way. But if that's what they need to do, then I'm going to hold the best faith I can and love and support them to go through that process.
Right. So also when you're coaching or mentoring someone, when you see them having that eureka moment, do you actually tell them to celebrate that moment as a moment of counting their blessings? And if so, what are some of the ways that they should celebrate?
Well, what I usually say is that, wow, you feel really different now that you shared that. what's going on for you? So I let them name, and I might say, well, what would you like to do with that? So they can decide that they've had this moment, they can really acknowledge it, they can really feel it, and then they can decide, well, it might be celebrated, it might be I'm going to do this thing differently. I tend to hand it over to them because I keep on finding that if I tell them what I think they should do, it's never as good as what they come up with. It's like it's very humbling. So I just sort of step back and that's the way I like to handle those really cool moments that we have as coaches and mentors.
Yes, indeed. And I like your style because it's the only thing that's different, in my opinion, is pretty much the wording, how we word things, but the outcome is actually the same. And I love when I'm keeping myself out of the person's situation, but allowing them to overcome any obstacles, to understand what they've gone through, and to celebrate the little successes that you have. Because when you undermine those little successes, then you tend to not recognize where you're doing good at versus where you were before we got started.
Yeah, and I think sometimes we just have to be really patient with our clients because I've had clients where they've had a eureka moment of really success and they come to a new knowing of how they want to do it, but they go back and they fall into the same patterns and programs and maybe they do it several times and finally they realize, whoa, this is what I've been doing. And sometimes they just have to go through that. We have to be really kind and patient because I know I'll put my hand up. I've done in my youth, I was a master at that. So they don't always get it the first time. Sometimes they have to fall on their face and pick themselves back up a few times before they go, I am so tired of this. I'm really ready to take this step forward.
True, true. That is so true. Oh my goodness. So I know that we're getting close to our time. So do me a favor, please. Give us some people some motivation to take us out.
Well, I just think that the best thing you can do is just to view everything as an opportunity to learn and grow, even if it's really challenging, even if you feel horrible. Instead of beating yourself up, tell yourself, I made a mistake. What I said, what I did is not who I am. And this is an opportunity to learn and grow. And I know that I'm better than that. And I'm going to give it a go. I'm going to feel into how I could do it better next time. And I'm going to make it a conscious effort to really notice when I'm not treating myself with kindness and patience and tolerance. And I know that I do that for other people. I'm going to bring that back to myself, see how that feels, play with it, and then, take it from there.
Yes. Oh my goodness. Powerful, powerful, powerful. Powerful.
Spiritual warrior.
Yes, indeed. I love these moments when most of the people come with some really good things. They come with some really powerful motivational techniques or tactics or speeches, things that they come with, because a lot of the people that I talk to, some of my people will send me comments or DM me and on my social media, and they like, man, I really like what such and such said at the end of the podcast, because I get the people that watch the podcast, and it's a beautiful thing. I really love that they're paying attention to a lot of things that you all are saying, because that's the goal. That's
Yeah.
the goal.
When we speak from our hearts, like we're having this conversation now, it's so often that we just say the thing that someone needed to hear. And it's really great to have that reflection back and know that, that it is making a difference, so that's really cool.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So please let us know where we can actually reach you.
Sure. Well, my phone is 720-936-2634. The quickest way to get me is to text me. My business is Jewel Consultancy, JEWEL Consultancy. And you can also find me under Arlene Cohen Miller on LinkedIn, on Instagram, on Facebook. So I'd love to hear from you. If you have something and you want to have a chat. Oh, and if you refer to this show, YTP Entertainment and remind me of that, I'll be happy to schedule a free discovery session with you. That's my little gift to your audience.
Awesome sauce. Thank you so much, Miss Arlene. Thank you. Thank you very much. I greatly appreciate you being on YCP Entertainment. It's been a true blessing. Thank you. And I definitely had fun. We learned a lot from you. And I'm looking forward to learning more from you because I will definitely be following you on social media. I'm on all those platforms as well.
Thank
So
you. Well, you.
just look out for me. I'll be right there.
Okay, that sounds great.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining YTP Entertainment. It's been a true blessing. Peace and blessings, and we are out of here. Have a wonderful day. And please, by all means, look for me. I'll be there. I'll be there on social media waiting.